What's up, guys? It's Chris Majestic here of Majestex, and this is going to be part two of the home automation series. So I did mention a few hubs in part one, but I want to go in a little bit more detail about those hubs now. So as I said in the first video, I normally recommend SmartThings to most people, and that's for a number of reasons. The very first reason is because right now it's the most compatible with other devices and hubs, and because right now it's really one of the most capable and customizable hubs out there while still kind of remaining easy to use. And the other hub that I mentioned was the Wink Hub. Now the Wink Hub has some issues, but as far as simplicity goes, it's going to be really hard to do better than the Wink Hub when it comes to being simple, with the main issue just being that it's not as reliable. Now, Wink did recently release the Wink 2 Hub. Now, from what I've seen, they have fixed the issues that it had with reliability, but it's still fairly limited when you're comparing it to something like SmartThings, so I still would recommend SmartThings over Wink. And some other hubs is Google Home and the Amazon Echo. Now, the Google Home and Amazon Echo hubs do not have direct support for any other protocols other than just Wi-Fi and Bluetooth, so you can't buy like a Z-Wave switch and use it with Amazon Echo by itself or Google Home by itself. You have to have another hub to do that with. However, you can take the Google Home or the Amazon Echo and link that to your SmartThings hub. That way you can actually control your devices with voice. And another hub you might see out there, usually not in the stores too much, but online you'll see the Mikasa Verde hubs. Now, this actually was kind of one of the hubs that started this whole thing here. Before you had things like SmartThings version 2 and all these other hubs that are out there now, you had this hub. And this is actually not a cloud-based hub. This is all local, so it's really fast. The only downside is it's Z-Wave only, and it's not really as simple to use as some of the more modern hubs that are out there now that you find in retail. Now, I already mentioned in the last video that these hubs support different protocols. Now, you do need to have a general understanding of how these protocols work. So, for example, I'll use Z-Wave, and some of the other ones work the same way. So, let's say you buy a SmartThings hub, you wire that into your basement up to your router, and let's say you bought a wall outlet or something like that. You plug the wall outlet all the way up in your bedroom, and you plug that in, you have a lamp there. Now, it may have a slight delay. It may take 1 or 2 seconds for the lamp to cut off when you hit the button. Not really a big deal. However, you can actually improve the connection between your devices and the hub by simply adding more devices. So when you have multiple Z-Wave devices around your house, it actually creates a mesh network. So the more devices you have, the more stable and fast your actual connection is. All right, so I wanna give you an example of how to actually add a Z-Wave device. And what I have here is an Aeon Labs wall switch. This is just a regular wall switch. It looks just a little bit different than some of the other ones here. And the process to add a Z-Wave device to SmartThings is called include. So a device has to be in include mode in order for SmartThings to see it. And in order to remove a device, it has to be in exclude mode. So the very first thing we're gonna do is fire up SmartThings. We're gonna go to home, and then you're gonna go all the way to the bottom. So you see all your devices here, and then you see add a thing. So you hit add a thing, it says looking for devices. Now all devices are different, but they all have a button on them somewhere that you can hit to put the device in include mode. So that's what I just did there. I hit the button to put the device in include mode, and boom, there you see, Z-Wave metering switch. So that's this device. So it automatically adds it. And then you can actually tap on it if you wanna rename it. And I'll call this Christmas lights. Boom, so it's Christmas lights. You hit save. Confirm, it's saying it's adding one device. Great, that's it. There's Christmas lights, right? So I'm just gonna plug this in. There you go. So the Echo Dot's getting power. Now if I go in here and hit the button, it turns it off. An important thing to keep in mind when you're dealing with Z-Wave devices is that it's important to exclude it if you're gonna take it off of your network. So let's say you wanna give this to a friend or you wanna sell it or something like that. You have to make sure that you exclude it from your hub, or else the next person is actually gonna have trouble pairing this to their hub because it thinks that it's still included into your network or on your hub. So in order to exclude a device, we're gonna go to settings right here. You're gonna go to remove. It's gonna say, you wanna remove it, are you sure? Yes, I'm gonna hit remove. Now it's waiting for this to go in exclude mode, so if I hit the button on that, boom, there you go. The device has been successfully removed from SmartThings, and that's it. Now, part three of the video is actually gonna be more in depth in the SmartThings app and how to get these things to work and how to get the other smart hubs to work together, so stay tuned for that. Now, while you're gonna deal with lighting with these devices, there's really three different options you have, and I didn't mention this in the first video. The first way is gonna be a switch, whether you wanna buy a Z-Wave or a Zigbee wall switch. The second way is gonna be just an outlet, whether you wanna replace an outlet in your house to plug a lamp or something into it. And the third way is the simplest way, which is gonna be to use bulbs. So now I do wanna go into a little bit more detail about wall switches, since they are a little bit more advanced and more difficult to understand. All right, so both of these you see here are actually Z-Wave dimmer switches. So these actually wire into the wall like a regular light switch. So you do have to know a little bit about electricity and be comfortable with wiring in order to do this. So I would normally recommend a Z-Wave dimmer to somebody that has a lot of different lights. So this is controlling my basement lights, and I have about 15 bulbs all on one circuit. So it really wouldn't make sense for me to buy a whole bunch of connected bulbs, because it could get really pricey. So instead, you'd rather spend, you know, 30 or 40 bucks on just a dimmer, and that controls all of the lights. But the one thing to keep in mind that's really important if you want to go this route is to make sure that you have a neutral wire in the box. And the neutral wire is usually just a wire in the back of the box that's coiled up and taped off, because it's not really used for just regular light switches, but you do need it for a Z-Wave switch. And the reason why is because the Z-Wave switch is always on, it's always powered on, because it needs to have a constant connection to your hub. So that's going to provide it with the power it needs to stay connected. So if you're working with lights in the ceiling, the only other alternative is to actually just buy connected bulbs. And the other thing I want to mention about Z-Wave light switches is about three-way or four-way situations. So if you don't know, a three-way lighting situation is when you have two switches controlling one light. So what you're going to need to do is buy an actual Z-Wave switch, and you need to buy what's called a Z-Wave accessory switch. Now, the Z-Wave accessory switches usually look just like regular Z-Wave switches, but they don't actually control the load, or they don't actually have a direct connection to the light. So in a three-way lighting situation, only one of the switches is actually connected to the light. So you need to make sure you're putting the Z-Wave switch on the side where the actual light is connected, and wire that into the load wire, or the wire that's going to the light. And the other end is where the accessory switch is gonna go. All it's doing is getting power and using itself as a completely independent switch. So when you're dealing with these accessory Z-Wave switches, you have two options on making it work. You can actually buy what's called a Z-Wave remote, and what that's going to do is pair your accessory switch with your regular switch, so that anytime you hit the accessory switch, it switches this off, or vice versa for on or off. The alternative is to simply just wire up the accessory switch for power, and whenever you hit that switch, you can tell SmartThings what to do when you hit that switch. So in my case, at the top of my steps, I have an accessory switch there because the load is not at the top of the steps. When I hit that light to turn it on or off, I have SmartThings say, hey, when I turn this switch off, turn this switch off. Or when I turn that switch on, turn this switch on. So you can have SmartThings do all the things for you, but the cool part about it is you can actually have SmartThings do more than just that. It doesn't have to necessarily control a light. It can control whatever you want. It's just an accessory switch that happens to look like a light switch. And the last thing I want to talk about, because I get this question a lot, especially with the Amazon Echo videos and the very first home automation video, is how to control TVs. That's just going to be the Logitech Harmony Hub. Now, Logitech has made it super complicated because they recently changed all the names of their remotes and hubs. Now, they do have an option where you can just buy the hub by itself, and they have another one where you can buy the hub with a smart remote. As long as you're getting a hub with it, you can use that hub to link with Amazon Echo and with SmartThings. The way the Logitech Harmony Hub, or the Harmony remotes for that matter, work is that they actually have activities. What happens is the SmartThings app can actually tie into the Logitech Harmony servers and actually see those activities you have there, and it'll turn each of those activities into a switch in SmartThings. So it's that simple. Whenever that activity is not activated, that switch is off. Whenever the activity is activated, that switch is on. So you can just go in SmartThings and hit the switch to turn it on, and that's gonna turn your activity on, start your TV. Same with the Amazon Echo. The Alexa app is gonna log into Logitech servers, do the same exact thing. But the cool part is with Alexa, you can just say, hey, turn the TV on. It's gonna switch on the activity, so you can use your voice. All right, so let's recap real quick. If you wanna be able to control a Z-Wave or a Zigbee device with voice, you would need either the Amazon Echo or the Google Home, and you would need the SmartThings hub, and you would need to buy that Z-Wave device. Because again, the Echo and the Google Home do not work directly with Z-Wave or Zigbee devices. They only work with Wi-Fi based devices. All right, guys, well, that's it for this video. Hopefully you found it helpful. Go ahead and mash that like button for me if you did. And I do want to hear your comments and your questions. I'll go ahead and respond to those, so you can post those in the comment section. And I'll see you guys in the next video.